How beautiful it all is. How beautiful it all is. It's just a fabulous day. Cloudy, rainy day in the Bay Area. Amazing. But it's beautiful. I love it. So, welcome to the video. Jesus wants me to keep on taping. I'm saying, like, wow, Jesus, it's really rough right now, huh? And the future is like so up in the air, you just don't know what's what. But I'm driving along today and I sort of feel like everything is just consciousness. But it's one consciousness. It's not tree consciousness, it's not this, you know, road consciousness. It's just one life, one consciousness. And I sort of said, you know what? Yeah, I can accept that. Why don't we accept that? So we'd like to get to that, right? There's just one life. That's all there is, just one life. There's not many lives, there's just one life. And we need to keep hearing this, even though it's like, what? Okay, so let's do the best we can here. As we transition into this new way, the new age of no age, of no way, the new way of no way. Because there's only intrinsicness. There's only intrinsicness. That's all there is. So, in this new age, there's two different divergent ways. And there are those who are going to accept there's only intrinsicness. The I is a label applied to the wished for absence of reality, absence of intrinsicness. There's somewhere something isn't intrinsicness. There's no such situation as that. So it's a label for nothing. The I is a label for nothing. And so those who go towards worshiping, I'll put it to you this way. The goddess worship, mother goddess worship, is really a cover. Okay, it's a disguise, a camouflage, a nice fluffy feel-good camouflage for worshiping time. And time is a camouflage for worshiping the ego. And the ego is a camouflage for worshiping the I. And the I is a camouflage for worshiping the absence of reality, our desire for worshiping ourself, okay, for spirit worshiping itself. And that's a camouflage for what? The desire to be greater than God. So you have this belief system and of a creatureness, and it on the most superficial level, it's mother goddess worship, which is worshiping time, space, process, and form, structure. Okay. Which is again camouflaging our worshiping of the ego. Egoic consciousness, so to speak, a belief that there's a separate consciousness, a thingness, there's something other than intrinsicness. And then that's a camouflage for worshiping of the I, which is the label that we apply, the first label, I, labeling absence, stands for the absence of reality somewhere, this absence of intrinsicness. And then that desire, absence of intrinsicness, is really our desire to be greater than God. You know, it's worshiping, try to worship ourselves, which is our desire to be greater than God. That's the constellation of delusion. And we could just look at that and say, oh, yeah, okay, that's the rundown. And like the United Nations is the instrument of mother God worship. Divine feminine, mother, matriarchy, mother, structure, time, space, process, form. It's a camouflage, a feel-good camouflage. That's all it is. That's all it is. But so if you're not into all this ego, this constellation of trying to be greater than God, then this stuff just really, you know, isn't interesting. This world of mother, you know, matriarchy, feminism, mother God worship, divine feminine, you know, goddess worship, it just isn't interesting. There's no attraction to it because it's a camouflage. It's just a camouflage, and we use it as a camouflage because it seems to be nice and fluffy for us to think, oh yeah, this is okay. We don't understand what is it fronting for. It's a facade, a front for self-worship in an attempt to be greater than God, believing that we can be absent from reality, from intrinsicness. Everything, all is intrinsicness. There's no thingness. There's only intrinsicness. There's only intrinsicness. There's no thingness. So Jesus asked me to speak up, keep speaking up. He says, those who are teachers, who are able to speak up, he says, very vitally important that they speak up and share the ideas with everyone. This is how ideas grow in strength, by being shared. This is what he said. Well, I pray that more listen and share these ideas so they grow in strength, because it seems like, you know, I'd rather have, you know, these ideas really, really, but who knows where they're resonating. I can't really know what's going on. I just keep doing it. And he asked me to keep doing it. So what can I say? Intrinsicness, intrinsicness, intrinsicness. A nice little bird just sort of floated down. Hi, bird. Oh, floating down in the air and going back up. Very nice. It just showed me something. Circling back. Speaking of this, what do we need to do then to break out of this dreadful facade upon facade upon facade? How many facades are there? Right? The mother goddess worship, facade for time, space, process, and form worship, structure worship, form worship, facade for the ego, facade for the I, facade for the self-worship, which is facade for trying to be greater than God. So, I mean, you got five facades hiding this desire to be greater than God. Five facades. And how do we lose interest in those facades? I mean, really, liberation is really just losing interest. Okay, that's all it is. Don't think that you triumph over anything. You just lose interest in it. You see it clearly enough and you say, wow, that's really not as interesting to me anymore. It used to be, but that's because I was caught up in my cleverness. You know, I was caught up in my cleverness. And look at this facades. I can really, you know, my creativity is being so clever to build these facades. I think I'm insulating myself from it all. And now I just see, you know, it's all just nonsense. I didn't insulate myself from intrinsicness at all. It's all intrinsicness is all there is. So how do we loop back to this, where we're at right now? United Nations, you know, Sustainable Development Goals really is hiding camouflage for their agenda, which is Mother Goddess worship, plain and simple. They've written it out even in black and white. There's no hiding it. They don't hide it. Oh, a little bird again. So that's, you know, trying to build a better facade. Okay. And at some point, you lose interest in that. That's all. We're not condemning our folly. We just say, you know, I'm not interested in it anymore. That's all. What do? We return, we loop back and return to monastic culture is what we do. But this time, monastic culture will be much better informed. And there's different styles to that. You know, it's not like you'd be holed up in some, the negative aspect of that really it is in our imagination. It's actually, monastic culture is actually fabulous. Absolutely fabulous. We think of those gurus in the Himalayas and their caves. Oh, it's so terrible. No, it isn't. Those are like sumptuous townhouses for that area. I mean, these caves were only reserved for like the top meditators, and because they were so nice compared to the average person's dwelling. I mean, these caves were insulated, protected from wild animals, protected from the elements and everything like that. I mean, what a great place to live. So they lived a great life. There's no question about it. Beautiful, beautiful places. They traveled a lot around to really gorgeous places, like in the Himalayan mountains. It's not a bad life. It wasn't a bad life for them at all. It's the poor people who were trying to worship the mother goddess who had the terrible lives, you know? So, yeah. monasticism is way better culture than what we have right now. You can't even compare it. What it does is, of course, it enables us to practice presence. I was talking with someone today about that. He said, "My God, it's just, you can't believe my life, and it's just the pressure's nonstop. You're not doing this. 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 I can't breathe." You know? And it's that way everywhere here. And I said, "Yeah, I mean, you really need to practice presence and feel presence. Just like, you know what? I don't have any agenda, and I'm just feeling the presence. I'm just feeling presence everywhere. I'm feeling the one life. I'm feeling what? What is presence? Intrinsicness, which is all there is. Which is all there is." So in monastic culture, you get to slow down and experience intrinsicness, presence. It's fabulous culture. So we need to loop back from this misadventure and get back to monasticism, but this time the wisdom is saying, "Wow, you know, when we departed from monastic culture out of curiosity, like, I wonder, you know, how we can, you know, can we?" We didn't realize what a terrible decision that was. We do now. So we come back much wiser, and we know that whenever we abandon monastic culture, it always collapses into Mother Goddess worship, always, which is a facade, again, for time, worship of time, space, process, form, structure, which is a facade for, okay, and the five facades. It always collapses back into that, guaranteed. Now that we know that, we don't have any interest in wandering away from monastic culture. We know how it goes. We don't need to keep finding out over and over and over again. It's ridiculous, right? At some point, you say, "I've been there and done that enough times, so I know it can't go any other way. It can't go any other way. You have to build facades." And you eventually, it's like as it is now in the world, and it's so blaringly obvious now that only someone who believes they're a creature can't see it. You know, you have to believe like you're dumber than a dog to not see what's going on in this world. Probably dogs look at us and say, "What's the matter with you guys?" You know, they know we're messed up. I'm sure they do. And I act differently towards dogs, and the dogs know it. They're kind of like, "Huh, he's different. He's not like slathering all over me, like, oh, like trying to idolize me. He's got presence." The dog says, "Good. It's reassuring." Yeah. So there's only intrinsicness. Okay, intrinsicness. There's only, I don't like the term consciousness. Okay, I've never resonated with it. It's a fine term for those who resonate with that, because what they're getting at is the same. It's the same. It's only one, just one consciousness. But I never have been comfortable with that term. But intrinsicness, I like intrinsicness. It's a very powerful term. I love that term. So abstract, right? Just intrinsicness. Nothing can depart. It's not created. It's intrinsic. There's only intrinsicness. That's all there is. Get that? There's only intrinsicness. That's all there is. Anything else is just a dream of facades. That's all. Facades trying to hide the fact that it's just a blatant, ridiculous attempt to try and usurp, you know, the prime creator position, be greater than the prime creator of intrinsicness. God is intrinsicness. Intrinsicness is all there is. There's only intrinsicness. And imagine, don't imagine how we'd feel, but keep working, trending towards it, of experiencing the intrinsicness, because that is what monastic life will bring us to, monastic culture. We will realize all is intrinsicness, and we're abiding in it. More than that, we are it. Everything is it. There's only it. There's only this. There's only this. There's only intrinsicness. And we'll be liberated from suffering. And it's just a fabulous, fabulous culture. Uh, And the middle ground between that and creatureness is disappearing, isn't it? It's disappearing. The middle class was a time when we could decide which way we're going to go. But the middle class is now being crushed. Globalization is just crushing it. And so you have to decide which way to go now. You can't, you know, you can't sit on the fence really in this world any longer. I was cleaning some, I peeled this label off my phone today. There's a label's been on there, just attention, you can shift your card over to AT&T. It's just a nonsense label. And I just pulled it off. It was all gummy around the edges. So I said, I gotta get some goo gone. And so I took the bottle. I was trying to squeeze it all out. And I forgot that the little pinhole thing that they put on the top, they just used this piece of cardboard now. It just came off. It's really flimsy, really bad design. And so the mouth of the bottle was wide open. And so I tipped it like this and it poured out and poured over my phone. And it ruined, I can't hear anything. I can't hear any incoming calls, and I can't hear what they're saying. So I thought, oh my gosh, I ruined my phone, and I don't want to get a smartphone. I'm doomed. It was horrible. But it works on speakerphone. I found out if you put on speakerphone, it works, except I can't hear the ringing of any incoming calls. I don't know what to say. Maybe that's a good thing, right? No, I'm not bothered anymore by incoming calls. I can check the phone and see if anybody called me, but I can't really hear the. It's like on silent mode all the time. Did anyone call me? Let me see. No. So I kind of have to keep it on recent calls is kind of what I have to do, I guess. Yeah. But I was really bummed out because I realized that, you know, the technology smartphone is just a facade too, and it's a way to soft sell, you know, this whole structure of five facades, saying, you know, don't worry, we can fluff it up for you and get it nice and just kick the can down the road, right? And we know how that goes, right? That's all that creatures can seem to do is kick the can down the road. The creatures can't become dharmic. We have to realize that we're not really a creature. You can't say, I'm a creature, and then become dharmic. It's not possible. Dharmic is a realization. This is all facade. We've never been a creature. There's no real creatureness. It's just intrinsicness. There's only intrinsicness, and then our attempt to hide this from ourselves. And don't try to imagine or think about it. You know, just kind of get used to hearing this, and then your reaction to it, because you already know this is so. You don't have to think about it to know that it's so. We already know this is so. Ordered another club today, so I'm on the move. You know, I realized, wow, something wasn't quite right. I said, yeah, I was right. I've got this huge gap between 12.5 degrees and 22. What am I going to do? Well, I found this hybrid. It's adjustable. I can adjust it from 13 degrees to like 17 or something. I said, that's perfect. I'll put it like 17 or 16.5 or something. And then so that it covers this gap that I had now, this gap. So I'm feeling, oh my gosh, I'm really, really taking care of the gap problem that I've been having. It's just changing everything. I don't even know what to say. Everything's really in change. Completely different, really set up based on playing it safe and more conservatively playing it safe and conservatively. Speaking of that, on the freeway today, there was this someone in a Chrysler Town and Country minivan who was driving like a maniac with gray sides to the car, and he drove into the, he zoomed past me, weaving through, and then he wove back into to the left into the fast lane. And basically, he was going to go straight into the car in the fast lane. Like, they didn't even see it. He was weaving so fast, it was just going to smash right into him. They're going like 75, or he was going like 85. And it was right in front of me. And I said, uh-oh. And the car suddenly saw it, that the one that was already in the fast lane, and they slammed on the brakes, almost locked up the brakes, and barely allowed them to go in without having an accident. Almost clipped the front fender of this car. If they hadn't hit the brakes, they would have smashed broadside right into that car at 85 miles an hour. It would have been a horrendous accident. And I just say, are you kidding me? And of course, the car didn't do anything. It didn't honk, nothing. Nobody does anything here. Nobody does anything. A bunch of enablers here. Unbelievable. And then just a little bit later, the highway patrol on the side, I said, highway patrol, I wanted to stop and say, go get that car. That guy is going to kill somebody, such a maniac. Well, I don't know. Maybe it was an attention getter for me. I try to look at everything that way. It's all the grace of God. And try not to get upset. Maybe it had something to do with saying, hey, you've got a gap problem there or something. Right? It could have been. Like, hey, you need to cover this gap. Get up. Don't try to come in like that. Yeah, it's probably that was it. God works in mysterious ways. You should always understand. Never underestimate how the grace of God is working in your life. It does it in every which way. Every which way. Every which way. There's nothing that it cannot use to get your attention. So we keep waiting for the angels to show up in our lives. And, you know, all the while, they are showing up in our lives through all these little incidents that we have that take place. Attention getters. If something's an attention getter for you, just bank on it. That's the grace of God is trying to get your attention. So I pulled the trigger on that hybrid. It's a hybrid. And I wasn't even thinking about that. I was looking for a head cover for my hybrids, and I couldn't quite find the one I wanted. And then I suddenly saw this. It just clicked in my mind. Why don't I get a hybrid? I don't know how it happened. Somehow, I just searched for it on a whim, and I said, "Oh my gosh, it's adjustable. I can do that. It's the same brand that I'm using now, and it's cheap. It's amazing." It just revolutionizes my whole game into a whole different level. It's just, what can I say? I don't know what to say. Similar to what we're doing here with our practicing. It's a new way. It's a new set of golf setup. It's a new practice setup here with, I can't do anything. I don't know anything. I have no talent at all. We talk about this I, which is just a label for the absence of reality, absence of intrinsicness, which doesn't exist. There's no absence. So it's a label for really nothing at all. So we need to gradually stop valuing this label in our judgments of you know, beauty contest of which label's the best for what doesn't exist at all. Which label's the best? You know, we got to lose interest in this beauty contest that we're having. And so we say, look, I don't know anything. I'll never know anything. I have absolutely no talent whatsoever. Consider saying that. I have absolutely no talent whatsoever. I don't even have the talent to die. I really don't have the talent to die. I have no talent. I have absolutely no talent. Dying is just an attempt to give the eye some talent, you know? Got the talent to die, but I'm admitting I don't even have the talent to die. I have no talent whatsoever. Don't have the talent to age. I don't have the talent to get sick. I don't even have the talent to get born. I'm devoid of any talent, completely devoid. So you stop trying to give the I talent, which means you don't need conditioned existence, this farce of you don't need to view it that way. You don't need to be born and age and die and all this, you know, conditioned existence, as they call it. You don't need that, because that's just an attempt to give talent to the I, and you're admitting, I don't have any talent. I'll never have any talent. I'll never have even the slightest trace of talent. Hallelujah. So this is the new way. You can feel it, right? Obviously, we have a new setup here. And it's a powerful setup. Just like the golf clubs I'm getting. It's a powerful setup I'm getting. Very powerful. And I'm aware of it because I've been working out for 2 years to get stronger, and I'm still working out every day, and I trusted God. God said, you do the workout, I'll set you up, don't worry. And he's doing just that. God's doing just that. God is doing just that, giving me a very powerful setup to match, you know, the strength that I have. Isn't that amazing? I never even considered doing that, what I'm doing now, because I didn't have the strength to do it. It made no sense. It made no sense. But now I'm saying, yeah, I could do this. It's the same on the spiritual path. what the kind of assertions we're doing now. We never even considered doing this before. It's too difficult. But now it's like, yeah, I could do this. I have absolutely no talent at all. I'll never have the slightest talent, ever. Now, for those who are trying to build up the resume of the ego, trying to give it something, that's blasphemy to them. Utterly blasphemous, what we're saying. But we know it's actually liberation, practicing liberation, trending towards liberation from absurdity. A label? We're trying to give a label for nothing? Talent? Talent in what? It's empty of everything. The eye is totally empty. The eye is completely empty. Absolutely empty. And in that recognition that it's completely empty, we then are aware of intrinsicness, which is complete fullness. So practice saying, I have no talent. I have no talent at all. I have absolutely no talent at all. I don't know anything. I'll never know anything. There's nothing I can do. There's absolutely nothing I can do. I have no talent. I have no abilities whatsoever. I have zero ability. No abilities at all. Wow, I have no ability. I have no talent. I don't know anything. I have no value. I'm completely worthless. I can't change anything at all. I can't better anything at all. I can't do anything at all. I can't do anything at all. I can't accomplish anything. I absolutely cannot accomplish anything. Like, yeah. So I've been doing this about a week, and it's so much easier now. I just like, oh, yeah, it's wonderful. But I have to say this transition period has been pretty rough. Jitters, for sure. But it's getting easier. It's getting easier already. I was thinking, can I say this? You know, what? To the old regime, it's utter blasphemy. But to the new dispensation, it's the best music we've ever heard. I mean, I can say that I have no talent. In fact, I have zero talent, and I'll never have any talent. And just say hallelujah. That's like striking this chord of music, just like, that strikes the perfect chord. That's exactly what I want to hear. And of course, when we're speaking in conversation like this, we use the term I has two different levels of meaning, okay? There's the I that is just the speaker who refers to the intrinsicness that is speaking, and in the intrinsicness, in your case, that is listening. And there's the I, quote unquote, the little I, the label for the absence of intrinsicness that we know it stands for absolutely nothing at all. Okay, so obviously you understand there's two different levels of meaning. So I don't have any value at all. I have no value whatsoever. The little I has no value whatsoever. When we put it in that formulation, of course we're speaking of this, egoic little I, a label for the absence of reality, absence of intrinsicness, which doesn't exist. It's just wishful thinking. A label for nothing at all. Label for nothing at all. So this is the new way. This is the new way. And the more we get used to it, the better it will go for us. And we need this new way now because of the way the world is going. Okay, it's essential. And I'm really pleased for those who are still watching these videos, because that's a tremendous testimony to you, okay, to your dedication and your desire to get free of suffering. And as you get used to hearing this, and actually practicing and saying it, you might one day say it. It seems like the most revolutionary thing in history to say, I have absolutely no value whatsoever. I never will have even a tiny drop of value. Never. Not even a speck of value. I'm devoid of all value. I'm devoid of all talent. I'm devoid of all ability. I'm devoid of all sanity. I'm devoid of all capability. I'm devoid of all value. I'm devoid of all knowing. I'm utterly worthless, totally, utterly worthless. When you're able to say this, it'll be like a revolution. You say, oh my gosh, I never realize that I could say this. Yeah, I've been trying to build up this little eye. I've been trying to give it capabilities, you know, gift it with all this stuff. Gift it with talent to die. Said, look at this. Look how talented you are. You are able to take life and make it die. Wow, well, you are so talented. You're so talented. And of course, the worshiping of the facades, the Mother Goddess facade, is the worshiping of form, of bodies, of talent. We're trying to gift the eye with talent. So they say, come on, everybody, let's keep gifting the eye with talent. You know, one of these days, the eye is going to say, yeah, I'm really something. You know, I really have grown up. So how does a label for nothing grow up? How does a label for nothing, what can never exist, how does that grow up? How does it mature? Aren't we just playing a shell game with labels? Yeah. Wow. It's Friday. Beautiful. Clouds are sort of dissipating. I wish they'd stick around. I kind of enjoyed it today. It was just beautiful. It's different. It was misty. You know, what is it, June 9th or something, and it's misty and it's cool. Very rare here like this. So I thought it was a beautiful day. I didn't mind it at all. I said, this is fine. Oh, FedEx. I wonder if they have something for us. Maybe. I might have to break away here for a second. I don't know what it would be. So we're retooling our game. It's the new way of retooling our game here. Thank you. Very good. Have a great day. Okay. All right. I got what I was waiting for. That's terrific. No email on it. No. I was checking. There's nothing. I said, oh, maybe they forgot about us. No, it arrived today. Isn't that great? This is very helpful. That is really great. Wow. That's exciting. Because I'm tooling up for the new way. You know, I'm for the new day here. I'm preparing myself, and I said, I told the Dharma King, Jesus and the Dharma Kings, I said, I do it, I'm doing it, and getting ready for the next step, and just trusting them, there'll be a next step. And it takes a lot of trust, because the wherewithal, in my case, is at this point, is non-existent, You know, I just say, you know, you go in the hole a bit. You just say, wow, I just trust that, you know, they fulfilled their promise, the last promise. They absolutely fulfilled it, better than I imagined. It was way better than I imagined. It was just stunningly better than I imagined. And so why should I doubt them now when they have fulfilled what they said promised? Yeah, that would be foolish. It would be foolish. So. Just to get you this, you know, we're in this flavor of the new way, right? And so let's just be happy and relax and say, all right, and don't think we have to know it all. We don't. We're circling back and returning, joyously returning to really a type of sort of monastic culture, overall monastic culture. And there's many niches in this monastic culture, many niches. You don't have to just be someone contemplating for 30 years. No, it's not like that. We only hear the scary stuff. We tried to scare ourselves away from it. It's not like that, actually. It's not really like that at all. I've really lived a monastic life myself this lifetime. Absolutely, I have. I'm a lay monk, is really what I am. In the Nyingma tradition, there's often been a lay monk, okay, whether they're not in a monastery, they're out having a job, you know, whatever, and they're working, but they're really practicing, they're really a monk in their attitudes, in their determination. And so I am certainly that. So I have lived a life like that. Very challenging, but it's not Bodhidharma, you know, in a cave staring at a wall, which would be, you know, for some people that would be a blast, you know, that'd be great. So there might some to love doing that, but there's many niches in monastic culture. It's an entire culture, actually. And you will find it to be just, you know, immeasurably better than the present day and age culture. Immeasurably better. Immeasurably better. Night and day. Night and day. You actually get to say this if I have no talent at all. I have no talent at all. Isn't that great? Yeah. What talent can I have over nothing? You know, what talent do I have to make an absence of reality? None. I don't have any talent for reality to be absent. So the I have no talent at all. I have no talent whatsoever. Wow, this package, that was exciting, because I thought that they'd forgotten about us and something was wrong. But son of a gun, it came early even. This is just very exciting. God says he's going to do something. God is going to do something more and push it even more. It's going to be great. And so I know whatever he's going to do, it's going to be better than expected. So I continue to work out. I'm swinging a heavy-weighted, a really heavy-weighted club and trying to groove the strength of my swing. I'm able to swing it and imitate my swing with a really heavy club. I did barbell lifts from hanging a barbell down by your knees and then just lifting it straight up like that. A dumbbell, rather, 30-pound dumbbell. Did curls, you know, bicep curls. I pushed this heavy weight, pushing the heavy weight around. Did balance work. So yesterday was push-ups and various things. And just continuous everyday workout in some way. Everyday workout in some way. Feel pretty good today. Make sure that you do your recovery. You know, you eat right. Zero Greek yogurt, 0% fat is really, really great food for just plain. And I added blueberries, pecans, and walnuts, and some honey. You lose weight on that. There's very low calories. A lot of protein, very good for you. So I do that. I try and do that every morning. I had my kale smoothie today. That was really, really good. What did I do with that? Like six leaves of kale. Yeah, I had the whole smoothie. It was great. Some chocolate protein drink, chocolate protein powder, tart cherry juice, and six leaves of kale, big leaves of kale in a smoothie. And so I'm you know, doing that again, back to the kale, which is great, and I don't have any problem with it. It's got to be healthy, very healthy. And sticking with the plan here, and of course it's nervous and tense because it's new, it's different, and we're thinking, can we do it? Well, one step at a time. You know, and certainly retooling your whole approach is, you get nervous. And the external expression is retooling my golf bag, for instance. This is just a phenomenal retool. I've retooled my golf bag zillions of times, kind of. I mean, it's just almost continuously. But this is the most major one. It's the most audacious one. This is just like a pro setup. You know, it's just astonishing. And it's saying, hey, you know, you can play a different game now. That this is a different game you'll be playing, the way you're gonna have it set up. I said, yeah, I know that. Wow, this is really exciting, actually. Just like these affirmations are making, we realize there's a very different game we're playing now on the on our spiritual focus, right? It's a different game. It's a different focus than we've had before, obviously. It's way more powerful. It's directly addressing this I issue, okay? It's not just saying, well, there is no I. This is way more to the point of practicing. Like, I don't have any value at all. I don't have any value at all. I have absolutely no value. Jesus says, forget about the world entirely. He said, there's not one iota of this world that has any value to you or can help you in any way. Forget about the world entirely. And he says, as you abide in this soft, still, no-worldness, so to speak, he says, the lights of heaven will begin lighting up for you, one after the other, after the other, after the other, and they will keep lighting up, he says, until they all blend into just one light. This is directly what he said. So we need to practice dropping the world. He says, there's nothing here of any value for you. There's nothing here that can, for you at all. Nothing can help you here. Just do not even hold on to one thing that you think is precious to you. So there's nothing precious about this world at all. And he wants you to, he says, let your mind be free of this world and the seeking and the holding on. And because let it be free of that and experience this freedom. And just sit for a little while like that. Absolutely forget about the world entirely. And he said, then the light, and they'll imbibe of that, and the lights of heaven will start lighting up for you. But they're lights that only the mind can see. I said, the mind can see it very easily and naturally, intrinsically. He says, but the senses can't see it at all. They can't see it. Clear light, so to speak. Clear light, right? How can the senses see clear light? Wow. What a beautiful day. And I made it through the week. It was extremely difficult. I was very worried about this week. I didn't know if I was going to make it through. But God eased the workload off of my shoulders. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for that. And I said, we'll do it next week. It was amazing what happened. I was so worried. And God came up with the answer. Said, no, we'll get somebody else to do it. Do this and this and this and this. And I, all my troubles evaporated. But for a while there, I was thinking, I'm really going to have trouble. Dangerous work. So it's really dangerous work. And I'm so absent-minded right now. I'm in such shock of this new way, how it's unfolding and blooming. You know, I'm forgetting things. I'm not functioning very well. I'm absent-minded, and it's showing up. I did some things today. I said, what am I doing? I forgot this. I forgot that. I'm not sleeping hardly at all. My sleep is almost non-existent. I'm just waking up at 1 in the morning, 3 in the morning again, and dozing and just, you know, I'm really, but hey, it's okay, because this is really the entrance into a new way, a new dispensation. And again, the way of no way, the way of no way, absolutely no way, the way of no way. How can there be a way into intrinsicness when intrinsicness is all there is? There's no way. And the way is just a label. It's just a label. The path is just a label for the I. Like, what path does the I, can the I take that just legitimizes the I? The I is just a label for what doesn't exist. So how can a label for what doesn't exist be said to have any path? Path to where? For what? Where's the meaning in that? There's a zero meaning to it. So you say, I don't have any meaning at all. I don't have any meaning at all. I have no meaning whatsoever. I don't have any meaning at all. I have no meaning whatsoever. I have no meaning whatsoever. Surf's up, folks. Yeah, it really is. Because we are absolutely moving in to this new way, and the surf is building up. And say, wow, look at those waves. They're beautiful. What beautiful waves there are to surf. And we'll see the waves in a different way, won't we? Really, I've seen waves in a different way. I saw it yesterday in a whole different way. I never understood waves. But now I'm starting to understand them better, recognize it. Hey, wait a minute. What happens is, the ocean, there's this energy moving through the ocean, pushing the water. Energy transfer going in the ocean. And if the bottom of the ocean is just flat the energy transfer just keeps going like this, eventually inertia, you know, it slows down over distance, but it stays flat. The ocean stays pretty flat. But when it starts meaning resistance on the bottom, meaning where the bottom starts becoming shallower. Okay, what happens is the friction, it compresses the energy of the ocean into a smaller area, for one thing. So that builds up a waveform, kind of. But it also slows down the energy that is nearest to the floor of the ocean. As the floor of the ocean gets pushed up like a sandbar or something, the energy is moving through the ocean from bottom to top of the water. The stuff that hits that the bottom, it's kind of like meeting resistance. Like the bottom might be going up like that towards the beach, and here comes the water, and so the water, you know, hits that bottom, and it causes it to slow down. Whereas the water on the top is still traveling the same speed. It's still going just as fast. It's not slowing down as fast as the water nearer the bottom. And so that's why the wave then starts cresting and then breaks, because the water closer to the bottom is going slower than the water going on top, which is going faster. That's what's causing the wave to break, to curl over and break. Wow. Amazing. Never saw it that way. So I'm seeing waves in a different way, trying to see it how it really, really is, and understand why are the waves forming, why are they breaking, stuff like that. And this gives you an entirely different feel for the water and the waves. I almost got a pair of fins. We had yard day, everyone's getting rid of their junk, and somebody, I saw a pair of fins for your feet, and I could have grabbed them, but I think it's illegal to grab stuff that people put out for to be taken away on you know, yard clearance day or something. So I didn't do it. I said, you know, I almost did it, but then I might be out in the water belly boarding, and I don't know if I'm going to do that or not. It was tempting, but I said, no, just live within the law. You know, if you feel that there's some restriction on it, you know, let it be. Because they don't want people, you know, scavengers going around through all the streets, scavenging through these piles. You're not supposed to do that. Understandable. Because people would just pillage everything and then bring it to the flea market. Scavengers, absolutely they would. They would take just about everything. But then again, you know, why not? They can earn some money that way. And you know, they may obviously, poor people, I feel they have a right to scavenge, and they can make some money at the flea market. Why not? These are wealthy people getting rid of all their stuff they don't need anymore, and I don't know what happens to it. I think it's thrown away. I mean, but there's a lot of good stuff out there, actually, that could be brought to a flea market and recycled. There's a lot of junk also. Mostly outdoor furniture, bric-a-brac, going through, just seeing everything people are throwing away. You just, God, been there, done that. Everything's so flimsy. What was it said today? Someone was, acquaintance of mine was in a store, and he was going over the Coca-Cola machine. They have this big Coca-Cola machine indoors. And he says, I need a wake-up call here. I need a wake-up call. And I said, okay, how much is it? 60 cents. He put 60 cents in. Nothing works. Nothing works. He hits all the buttons, and nothing works. He said, doggone it. He says, you know, ever since they got this new machine, it's a piece of junk. You know, it doesn't work well at all. He said the old machine was way, way better. Never had any troubles with that old machine. It was great. This one. He said, this new stuff is terrible. And I said, it's that way with everything. All new stuff is junk compared to the older stuff. I said, you should have lived in the 50s and 60s. He was a younger guy. And you didn't expect anything to break. Seriously. I mean, when something broke, it was a shock to us. You buy a rake, and you say, this rake's going to last forever. How could it break? There's nothing to break. The wood handles, like hickory wood handle and cast steel, you know, rake or whatever, that rake's going to last forever. And I've seen barns and work areas where people have all these tools. They're 80, 100 years old. The tools are still fine, perfectly fine. They just sharpen them up when they need to. There's no sign of breakage in any of that stuff. I mean, we literally didn't expect anything to break. And when it did, it for me, it was a tremendous shock to me. It was devastating. Devastating. I was devastated by any sign of anything breaking. I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. Like, what in the heck went wrong? How is this possible that this broke? And we'd like to be around trees that, were hundreds of years old, and literally our expectations were whatever we bought, we didn't have to worry about it breaking. We still have all our cutlery and plates and flatware, silver, flatware, of all types of stuff. I remember we have cups from when I was like just a kid, 5-year-old. We're visiting down in Los Angeles. I think they gave us for gifts these metal cups, aluminum metal cups. They're still exactly as good as they were back then. No difference at all. Good old aluminum, right? And so I cannot get used to stuff breaking. I just can't get used to it. To me, it freaks me out. And everything breaks now. And this, the young guy said, no, he says, not that way anymore. He says, everything is just made to break. Everything is flimsy. Everything is flimsy. They all know it. Everybody knows it. I mean, so what has gone wrong with our culture that it's this way, that everything is so flimsy that it's guaranteed to break really soon? So this is, something I just cannot countenance it. I can't get used to it. It's an abhorrence to me, and I have to constantly deal with this stuff every day. Talking to people, say, is it it's that way with everything? Even the stuff that costs a lot of money is still flimsy. I talk to guys who deal with really high-end stuff, appliances and stuff. They say, no, it's all flimsy. It doesn't matter how much you pay. They still use the Neumann, like what, U47, something like that, in studios. They've been, they were recording in the 50s with those, in the maybe the 40s, 50s, 60s. All the fabulous vocal recordings were done on those these Neumann tube microphones, and they're still using them in the studios. If you want to buy one, it might cost you a couple hundred thousand dollars. Someone told me it probably costs like $200,000 to get one of those microphones. But if you want a really good recording, you're still using those microphones that were maybe manufactured in the 40s, in the 40s or 50s, But yeah, so they might be 70, 80, years old, and they're still great. They're still great. They might refurbish them or something, but can't beat them. You can't beat them. These days, you buy a microphone, how long is it going to last? You just know, you get a camera, you just know it's going to break in a year or two. Like a video camera. You just know it. It's going to break in a year. I can't afford that. Who can afford that? That's why these young people are so aggressive. It's survival on their part. They know that they're going to need a massive amount of money just to survive because everything is breaking. You have to just keep buying, 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 and healthcare is going up, 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 up. People, older people now, their whole life is consumed by trips to the doctor and medications and procedures. It's because it's consumed, consumed. Didn't used to be like that at all. Old people were still vitally, active in their interests and hobbies and pursuits. And they didn't, going to a doctor was something that they really, hardly thought about much at all, actually. What? Go to a doctor for what? I'm still alive. I'll see a doctor when I'm dead, was the attitude. I'll see a doctor when I'm dead. Anyway, so that's the culture we're in, and we need a better culture, to say the least. So it's bound to happen. It's bound to happen because this oscillates. We've gone through like a 500-year decline here, our culture. 500-year, at least 500-year decline. Terrible decline. And now we're bottoming out. We've really bottomed out. And for this point, we have to decide which way to go. Are we going to, take a reincarnation as a dog somewhere? Or are we going to take a reincarnation in a monastic culture somewhere? and start to retune into intrinsicness. Retune to that. Stop pretending that there's an absence of it somewhere and that we're seeking for this absence. It's like we're saying, I know there's an absence somewhere, I just got to find it. So I'm having to gear up for this search. You know, and all we do is gear up for this search to find it, to find what doesn't exist. And so we're trying to equip ourselves with all these talents and abilities. The eye. We're trying to equip the eye so it can finally find what it's looking for. It can never find what it's looking for. There's no absence of intrinsicness anywhere. So all this gearing up, you know, gearing the eye up is useless. For nothing at all. For nothing at all. But we say, we've given you such a nice world eye to empower yourself, you know, and what good is it? No good at all. So, you know, just going, switching over to just kind of keep it smooth here. We don't want to get too intense. Just golf game. What it used to be like, the yardage be like, driver maybe like 230, 3-wood, 210. And then you go to the 3-hybrid was like 185. The 4-hybrid is 175. The 5-hybrid be like 165. And then the 5-iron, 6-iron, like what, 155, 145, and you go down like that. But now it's completely changed. I have like, but the driver's like 8.5, which is like I'm looking at like 280, being able to drive it like 270 to 280. I'm looking at the range, you know, I can get it out there probably 275, most likely. And so then you're looking at the 3-wood, which is 12.5 now. It's like hitting that like maybe 240. Maybe getting that out there 240 is possible with a 3-wood. So then what do you do with this, all this yardage? I got a hybrid, 2-3 hybrid, which is, you probably hit it like 225 is possible. So you get that 225, 240, 270 kind of yardage like this. So 225, then the 3-hybrid that I have, I'll keep that. Maybe I can get that out now almost close to 200. So, and then from there on, it's the same. So I sort of had to fill this gap in as I stretch out the yardage with the driver and the 3-wood. It's getting out there further. There's a big yardage gap there. And that's what I'm doing. It's a completely different way of looking at it. If you can get off of 3-wood, 230, 240 off the tee, then what do you do with the holes you need to get off like 220, 225? Well, a 2-hybrid. Yeah, put it at like 16 or something. 16.5 maybe. 16.5 draw. And just smash that out there. And that may go about, you know, 215, 220, 225 actually. And that covers that whole yardage there, which is sort of in between yardage there. Wow. Amazing. That's pro, as a pro set, the pro kind of yards. That's what they're thinking, you know, because if they hit it 280 off the tee, you know, they have to have some way to get these other yardages, because you can't, a lot of times you can't hit it that far. You can get in too much trouble. You go in the lake. You said, I need to hit it 225 here. Well, there's your 2-hybrid. And they tee off, actually, they tee off going to pro tournaments. I've seen them, they tee off with hybrids a lot. I'm seeing them hit this hybrid. I said, you hit that just 230. I mean, what? It's like a driver for me. And they're hitting it beautifully straight. It's easy. It's a nice 230 shot there. It's like a 2-hybrid. Very safe shot for them. That's when they're playing really safe. Just hit a 230 of the 2-hybrid. We're fine. And then there's a shorter hole. Maybe the hole's only, you know, 350. So 230, 120 in, which is a pitching wedge, sand wedge for them. Easy pickings for them. So I'm, you know, complete retool. Right now it's just in progress as we speak. But I'm definitely keeping my fitness going so that I'll be able to actually slug it out there. And so it's a different echelon, just as our spiritual practice now is a different echelon. It is a different echelon. Same game, right, which we're making affirmations, powerful affirmations, but it's really much more powerful than before, much more powerful. Covers a lot more territory. The eyes that we're doing, we're looking at the eye. I can make no progress whatsoever. I can make no progress whatsoever. I'll never be able to make even the slightest bit of progress. Wow. Wow just summates the total recognition, all recognition that we can ever have. Let's just summate it as wow. And I already have it. I already know what the reaction is going to be. Final reaction, all reactions, is going to be just wow. That's it. Wow. I wanted to get some cheap golf balls so I could just smash them as hard as I could. The Holy Spirit blocked me. Blocked me. Blocked me. I was about to do it, and I had the golf balls, and I was going to the counter, and I checked, and my wallet didn't have my card. I couldn't do it. I was blocked. I said, ah. And then it wants me to go back to the Pro V1. Stick with the Pro V1s. I have some old ones. Stick with the old ones, because you're like professional. You're going into this professional like setup actually. So use the Pro V1s. Nothing wrong with that. I said, yeah, but what if I lose them? Well, everybody loses them, right? Yeah, right and left. Bring your water retriever or something. Maybe you can retrieve a bunch. I don't want to go fishing around for balls. That's undignified. If it's gone, it's gone. So, yeah, the heck with it. You hit another shot, it's going to go in the same place anyway. It's weird how that happens. It does. That's why I try never hit another second shot. Forget it. You know, it doesn't suit my eye. Let it go. You know, it's not going to get much better the second time around. That is for sure. So we just keep doing these affirmations and just let whatever happens, happens, you know. This is really, you know, powerful. You don't get anything better than this in monastic culture, these assertions we're doing right now. No, you don't. You don't. This is like top echelon of monastic culture, what we're practicing right now. I can do nothing. There's nothing I can do. I can make no progress ever. I'm incapable of any progress. I am totally incapable of any progress. I can never win. There's nothing I can win. There's nothing I can attain. I'm incapable of any attainment. That's like blasting at 300, what we're doing right now. Can I hit a 300? Yeah. It's possible if I really hit one just right and the conditions are right. And I've done it before, and I know I'm stronger now than I was before. I have better equipment, better know-how, better swing. So can I get, get it out there. If all things, if the fairway's hard enough, the swing is just right, everything comes together, yeah, you can get out there. 300, sure, why not? Or maybe it's downhill. And the wind is blowing 30 miles an hour. Downhill 30 miles an hour. Yeah. 360 could happen. I heard the long drive champion just hit it like 430. The guy who won the long drive champion, 430. Okay, so. But I don't think, you know, it's a level landing field and no wind, probably. I think the wind has to be a certain, you know, can't be over like 6 miles an hour, five or something. It's got to be, but so 430, that's a pretty good poke. I don't know what the swing speed would be for 430, like 135 miles an hour or something. I think my limbs might go flying out if I hit a swing that hard. I might lose a couple limbs. I think when I was young, I think I had a swing like 120 something, 125 or four or something. I don't know, but I think I, you know, went home and my back was like very basically ruptured. You know, it's just you know, I was trying to swing just like, you're gonna hurt yourself. Don't want to do that. So we don't want to do these assertions like 10 hours a day as hard as we can. We're just mixing them into the, we're getting them into the mix. This is a powerful workout we're doing. Powerful, powerful. It's like swinging a weighted club. You don't want to swing as hard as you can. You just want to build up your muscles gradually. So I'm not swinging real hard. So I'm taking it, you know, three quarter speed, just building the strength in my back. Okay, so you, if you're going to swing really hard, your back muscles better be really, really strong and limber and flexible. You don't want to hurt yourself. Okay, you don't want to hurt yourself. You don't want to guzzle energy drinks and saying, I'm going to sit here, I'm going to do for 5 hours, like, I have no value, I am worthless. This is too powerful for that. So that's why I say in monastic culture, you don't use drugs, you don't use stimulants to try to make yourself go faster. You don't want to, you want to go three-quarter speed. When you're using these powerful, powerful practices, go three-quarter speed. And so you have to have breaks, and you have to be relaxed. You cannot be on stimulants. You cannot be on caffeine and all these guarana and all this. There's so many stimulants out there. You can drink all these drinks. You can't do it that way. Can't do it. You will definitely be overwhelmed by a backlash if you do it that way. Just like if I just swing that weighted club PVC pipe with sand in it, if I just swing as hard as I can, I'm going to strain something. I'm going to hurt myself. So build up the muscles with this powerful practice, but don't hurt yourself. So do these assertions, but don't overdo it. A little goes a long way. The psyche is just like reverberating with shock. Like, oh my gosh, this is shocking. I had no idea I could ever get this far to say this. Wow, so shocking. It's very shocking. So I'm not going to do this video too long. And the Warriors game is coming up, which is a good excuse to stop the video at some point so we don't overdo it. But this is just kind of easing everybody into this the new era, the new dispensation, the new way. The new age, of no way, yeah, of intrinsicness, just intrinsicness. It's always been there. It's always been this way. We don't need to do anything to make it that way. We just need to stop hallucinating the absence of it. Stop judging which label is the right one for the absence which doesn't exist, a non-existent absence. Which label is the right one for non-existent absence? How could you say that? How could you come up with what's right and what's wrong in that case? I mean, it's meaningless, isn't it? You start to dawn upon us the meaninglessness of the dance of labels. So putting our faith in God, we put our faith in God, and that God will do something for us to help us. I'm going on faith like 100% right now. And you know, it is what it is, right? Because my future is just, I don't know. There's no way for me to cobble it together. I just keep following the advice of the Holy Spirit. It's just, you know, gear up in this way, get ready in this way. Okay, I'm doing it. I'm trying to get my weight back down. Someone saw me that hadn't seen me in a while, and suddenly said, "Oh my gosh, you're so thin. What's happened? You're so thin." And it's funny, I think of myself as thin. I think I'm fat. I said, I've gained like 5 pounds or something. I said, feel fat. I don't feel thin. So that's pretty interesting to show you how familiarity works. I'm so familiar with the way I am now that if I gain a couple pounds, I feel fat. Whereas someone else is looking at me, they're just marveling and say, oh my, I can't believe how thin you are. I get this all the time. People haven't seen me for a while. I said, look at you. I said, you're so thin. They can't get over it. But I'm so used to it, no, I don't have that issue at all. So you see how powerful familiarity is, how powerful it is. How you, when you get familiar, it just feels normal. I just feel normal. In fact, I feel overweight. I'm going to use this weekend to diet, actually. I got to drop that weight. I'm feeling fat. But in the overall scheme of things, to others, they think I'm really thin. And they can't get over it. Are you okay? You sure you're okay? But they say, yeah, but you're strong. You know? And people keep, it's another big change in my life I've seen. People keep putting their hand on my shoulder, or putting their hand around me, or putting my hand on my shoulder. Almost everybody does that to me now. Before, nobody did it to me. Nobody. I was untouchable. Now they kind of want to like put their hand on my shoulder. Maybe they're trying to see, are you okay? They just kind of reassure themselves, you're okay, aren't you? And they want to see, are you strong? Or are you like really weak? You got cancer or something? No, I'm strong. So they kind of like, maybe they're patting me to say, are you okay? It's amazing. Almost everybody I meet pats me on the back now. And I think that's trying to maybe just see, make sure that I'm okay. I don't know what it's about. I just consider maybe it's about that, or maybe they just want a little contact with me. I don't. Maybe I seem really friendly, or you know, it's that's a major change in my life. Before that never happened. Or maybe they're just trying to think I'm looking old, so they kind of, yeah, old timer, how are you? You know, you have to pat an old timer on the back. You don't tend to pat a young, you know, vigorous person on the back. You just don't do that. So maybe it's a sign of you know, they're thinking that I'm old. But really, I'm stronger than I've ever been. If my knee was okay, I'd be fitter than I've ever been. Moving better than I've ever moved. But I'm looking older for some reason. Thinner. Yeah, the thinness, I guess, gets people. But I don't want to be one of these porky type of old persons. You know, it just... doesn't seem right. I want to be lean and mean, you know, really fit and be able to just, you know, move quickly and just, you know, have this intensity for this new way. I want to go into it, you know, with this full intensity and strength, which we're doing. We're doing it. Balance work is always very, very important. Someone said that your belly button like is the center, you know, of your gravity and balance. I've been using that and just focusing on my belly button, and so I don't fall, and it's working. It's everything else that revolves around that. Also the head, you keep make sure your head is focused on where you want to be, and don't get your head out of alignment with what you're balancing on. Your head and your belly button. And so my balance is very good. So, you know, we're going into this new way with a lot of confidence and a lot of power and a lot of balance and agility to do it. And it requires that. I mean, just to pioneer a new way requires that, actually. So I decided, yeah, I'm going to go for it. That was a couple of years ago. I said, okay, all right, let's do our best. Let's do our best here. See how well we can do. Oh, I ordered this used club, and I did something I've never done before. It says option to regrip it. Do you want to regrip it? I said, yeah, because it's actually an old club. It says a value club. I mean, it's got a lot of wear on it. You know, I could have gotten something more expensive, but, you know, beggars can't be choosers, and I try to keep it as low as possible, as used. And so I said, oh, it's a value club. It's still perfectly usable, but it's got nicks, little nicks, and it's shown it's been used a lot. That's okay. It's a golf club. It still works fine. But what it enabled me to do is this, you want to regrip it. And sometimes if a club has been used over a long time, the grips get worn out. And I'm thinking like, hey, so I said, yeah. And so I got a brand new grip. They're going to grip it with a brand new grip. They showed me the grip, what it looked like, and it looks beautiful. I said, wow, that at least I'll get this feel like the grip is new, and that gives you some confidence. A new grip, the club is old, but the club head's really solid, and these clubs are really solid, and the shaft, I imagine, it's perfectly fine graphite shaft. So there's not going to be any trouble with that. But the new grip gives you a real strong feeling, like this club's great. So I did it. I did that one. Never done that before. You know, my whole life, I've never had anything re-gripped. I might have had a driver re-grip one time, but other than that, nothing. It's all worn grips, worn out grips. You know, it didn't matter. I just use a grip, whatever it is. I'll just deal with it. You know. But right now, a new grip, Golf Pride, new grip. So that's very exciting. What's going on? Very exciting. The 3-wood I got seemed to have a new grip on it too. It's really, the grip's just perfect condition. Wonderful grip. It's like, I recognize it. It's really great. I said, thank you. So new grips on the driver, 3-wood, the 2-hybrid, new grips. Awesome. I may get the other 2-hybrids re-gripped too. Possible. It's not that expensive. A new grip, new assertions, right? Where you feel, this is powerful. I feel like this is really going to work. That's how I feel. I feel like what we're doing now, that I have no value whatsoever, is very powerful. It really gets it out there, you know, in terms of the effectiveness of where we're going towards, what we're going towards. What we're going towards is really, is just dropping the imagination that there's an absence of intrinsicness somewhere, or that we can have a successful search for it. It's somewhere, or it can become, an absence can become, it's something that can happen through a process. You know, no, because the process itself is 100% intrinsicness. There's nothing but intrinsicness, and we're hallucinating the absence of it by manipulating labels and thinking that there's some structure, time, space, process, and form that is somehow trending away from intrinsicness. And when the vision, the guru vision occurs, we see it's all 100% intrinsicness. It's 100% intrinsicness, always has been. We've never even taken the first tiny step away from that. Nothing ever has. There's only intrinsicness everywhere. You can't even speak in terms of things or structures of it. It's just a decoration, ornamentation of intrinsicness ornamenting itself is all that's ever happened. And we're trending towards that for sure. For sure, there's nowhere else to trend towards. If you're going towards, you know, liberation from delusion. So I just have to wait and see, you know, what's going to happen with this practice, and what's going to happen with my golf game. It's a new game. I don't even know what I'm going to be like or any. I really cannot. Try not to even imagine it, actually. And, you know, I have a really good pair of golf shoes. I really love them, finally. And that's really important. And a really great golf hat. Different style of golf hat, never worn. Really different. And so everything is different. It's like a new persona there. It's going to be a new persona out there. And out with the old. I'm the old, it's like a different life. You know, it's like a new life now. It's really like a new life. It really is. With these assertions, that's a new life. And the golf thing I've set up, new golf life. Out with the old, in with the new. And so we're not being buried by the world at this point at all. We're not being buried because we're like being reborn, actually. With these assertions, really, it's a rebirth. It's a spiritual rebirth that we're experiencing. So it's important to not pay any attention to what's going on in the world, like trying to stay with the trends, like how to deal, because that hooks us into the old way we tried to look at stuff. Now, with this, where we're at, we're going to view ourselves in a new light, in a new confidence. Are we really being buried by the world? Maybe not at all, right? Maybe not at all. Maybe I'll feel, can a golf course really bury me? And I might feel like, you know what, not at all. Actually, not at all. I don't know. That'll be a new experience. But can a world really bury? Can any world really bury us when we have these assertions, ability to assert like we're asserting right now, the practice like we're practicing, and then wow it, meaning the totality of all the effectiveness of this is wow. I already know what the effectiveness would be. It's wow in terms of a label. That's the final label. Okay. The final label is wow. the tools that we have right now are such that can any world really bury us or intimidate us? This is something to just to raise up, to bring to light. Don't try to answer it, but it's a consideration, isn't it? It's a consideration. We may be able to answer that in a different way than we expect, right? Right now, we just say, wow, to this question, to this consideration. Can any world really even bury us at this point? Any world at all? Wow, what a consideration. Don't answer it. Don't struggle trying to answer this. But just kind of breathe the air of that consideration. Hey, I've been able to raise this consideration up. Like, it's on the table of consideration, right? I mean, it's possible that no world can bury us at all. That's a possibility, isn't it? Just like I'm saying, you know, it may be that no golf course can bury me at all, where I'm getting to right now. But I'm not going to say yes or no. I'm just going to say, wow, to this consideration. We've raised the consideration. And so why should we even worry about the world at this point? We're just gearing up. So we're not, since we're changing our setup here, let's not struggle with this question, you know, where we're at, where are we at with the world? We'll revisit that down the road a little bit. Once we get used to this new mindset, this new way that we have, we have a right to take a vacation from trying to assess, you know, where we're at with the world. But we just realized there is this consideration that we may end up not being incapable of being buried by any world, anywhere. That is highly possible, isn't it? See how it goes. But don't put it to the test yet, because it's not a fair test yet, because we're not yet comfortable, familiar enough with this practice. We're not familiar enough with this practice to put it to a fair test. So, but down the road, you know, hey, it's worth finding out, isn't it? It was worth going down that road. There's a promise, there's a consideration down that road, really. So what time is it? Okay, well, it's getting close to tip-off time. And I don't know what's going to happen. Not too worried about it, because what we have here is just really fabulous, what we're going through right now. But don't push it. Don't try to assess it. Just say, you know, at some point, maybe I'll just sort of dawn upon me, hey, you know, this is how it is now. So I don't know if golf course is going to still crush me or not. I haven't even taken this stuff out to the range. I don't, but you know, the arsenal is there. I'm thinking like, hey, this is a new life, actually. It's a new life. We worked hard for this new life. I really put everything on the line and have worked for it. It's really a new life. And I'm thinking about, someone asked me about my musical life. I realized, I was thinking like, yeah, I did have that life, but that was many lifetimes ago. I've actually lived many, many lifetimes in this one life. I've had many lives, many. And this one now is a new life. It's really a new life. All the way around. And so it takes us a while to get used to a new life, doesn't it? We're like kind of looking around, it's like, wow. But we can do it. We can absolutely do it. We are doing it. We are doing it. So how do I stay away from eating too much during this game if I watch it? Well, I don't have much to eat. There you go. Have to get like a smoothie with a bunch of frozen fruit so it's cold and just sip it. But what? Stay away from what? The chocolate. Definitely stay away from the chocolate. Only got half a bag of popcorn left. Don't have any chips. I was really smart and I didn't buy any chips. I almost did. I said, no, if I buy chips, I'm going to eat the whole bag and I'm going to gain 3 pounds. So forget it. Let's go. Now stick with the kale. So I got to figure out the nervousness. What do you do? I don't know. Let's see. What's that? Celebration? Everybody's celebrating our new life with the sirens. Isn't that great? Yeah, it's great. Okay, so we'll just stay in the flow here. This is really important that you're still watching the videos, because we really are going through this rebirth. A new birth. The birth of no birth. You know, the birth, we're being birthed into the realization of intrinsicness. We're being birthed into the realization of intrinsicness, what has always been and will always be. And there's nothing other than that. So, hallelujah. God be praised. All praise to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Really, the grace of God as it has worked to orchestrate this new birth, the birth into no birth at all. Right? Just intrinsicness as all there is. Hallelujah. Very great. And just wow is the sum total of all my reactions, and I have this right now, and it's that simple. It's all my reactions actually end up in this profound simplicity of just wow. And so just have faith that this is the fullness of your reaction to this what we're doing right now, and the shock of it all. And just say, wow, I have it. It's very simple, very easy, and just keep focusing on that. Just wow, that's all there is to it. All there is to it. Wow, wow, and wow.